Right, I made a video last year sometime called making a bushcraft sheath for an F1 or something, which has had more people watching it than any of the other videos. Some ridiculous amount of people have watched it, and it's had a lot of positive comments and everything. So I'm glad that people find that useful. The video is just a video with some music on, though there's no explanation to it, and I keep getting people asking me questions about different things that I'm doing in it, even though I've tried to make it quite clear. I think the problem is that I don't really class doing a sheath like this as a sort of beginner's project, whereas some people seem to have kind of waded in at the deep end and decided that that's the first thing that they're going to try and make. So some people are confusing themselves a little bit, but you know, whatever, that's up to whatever people want to do. Basically, in this video, we're going to make just the same sheath, pretty much. But I'm going to talk you through it, so obviously it's got a bit more explanation, and I'll explain why some of the things are done like they are. You will probably see that some of the things have changed slightly from the first video to the second video. That's purely because I've done a ridiculous amount of these sheaths. Everybody wants me to make this sheath to the point where I'm kind of, you know, a bit bored with it. But it's what people want a lot of the time. They seem very popular. So you know, a few of the construction methods might have changed a little bit. That's just me getting a bit more efficient and you know, refining the design, which is what I do with designs anyway. You know, if I make sort of 5, 10, 15 or something, you'll find by the 15th one you've changed a few things, and that's how it should be, really. It should be a constant refinement process, not changing things for the sake of changing things, but if you can change something for the better, then you know, go ahead and change it. I've also got some different tools now. You know, I think in the other video, like when I'm setting the press stud, you can see me outside on the back step, you know, banging away with hand press stud setting tools and things. I've got obviously the arbor press and that now, so that's all a little bit easier. I've got templates that are pre-cut and everything. So this is what we'll be using. Okay, so I have made myself an actual acrylic template for this. I've done that many. You can work your own templates out. Right, the camera battery ran out yesterday, so it's actually the day after now, and I've forgotten what I was talking about. We were going on about the types of knives, I think, that you can do these sheaths for. That was it, wasn't it? Yeah, basically you need a knife where the back of the blade and the top of the handle basically forms a nice straight line, or near enough a nice straight line, like a lot of bushcraft knives do. So things like these F1s, Woodlaw knives, Woodlaw clones, those kind of things are all okay. Anything that's got like a bump or a ramping, like a ramped Bravo F1's no good. Anything that's got a lot of curve on the blade doesn't really work. Essentially you want this nice straight line. The fold in the sheath is going to grip that line nicely, it's going to grip the handle nicely, everything's going to be nice and snug, and any welt's going to tuck up under the blade. So as long as you've got a reasonable amount of length to the knife, because obviously you want the sheath balanced, you need enough space for the strap set, etc., then you know, you can do this. But I mean, you can try it for any kind of knife you like. Just be aware that, you know, sometimes you're going to make sheath and it's going to be a bit duff if you're not careful. You need something on the handle to get the strap to do the retention against as well. So you can see on the F1 here that the handle swells in the middle, and then there's a dip towards the back here. That's where the strap will grip. The more of a swell you've got here to grip, the better. But you know, some knives don't have enough of a handle to grip onto, so you know, you need to make sure that you do the straps properly and get them as tight as they can, so that it can grab the knife well. Some knives have obviously a much more tapered handle, like I had a Bailey Raven in last week, and that has a very tapered handle, and in that sense, you know, it's a lot easier to actually grip the knife handle. So that's what we're going to do. I've got a plastic template that I've made. Obviously you can make your own templates out of card or plastic, or just measure it every time, or use, you know, print it on paper. So if I'm doing something that's individual, I'll just print it on paper, sellotape the paper down like you've seen, and just score through. You can do it that way, but I've done so many of these I'm working off a plastic template. I have it so it's right-handed. Obviously if I flip it upside down, it becomes left-handed. This is a right-handed sheath, so this is the right way up. And essentially, you know, for the template, it's got the collar section here. It's got a strap section there. It's not going to be used on this one because the strap's going to be separate, so I won't draw around there. And then it's got the fire steel loop that's integral there. But you can see the general shape of it. You can work out your own. You can work out your own templates. But for anything that you're making lots of like this, it's a lot easier if you make a proper template, because it's just a question then of drawing straight around your template and you're done. In sort of industrial leather places. At the big companies, they don't even do this. I've discovered is one reason why they're a lot quicker. At places like, you know, JRE and Hedgehog and things like that, they make like it almost looks, you know, when you make biscuits and you get like what they call cookie cutters, where it's like a metal shape and you press it into some dough and like cut the shape of a biscuit out. You can get those made for like leather shapes, and then you have like a massive industrial press. What they do basically is they just put the leather down on a bed, put the cutting shape on, and they have this huge like air press. So you just press a button with your foot, and it basically chops the shape out of the leather for you straight away, and then you're done. And it puts all the holes in the right places and everything. So mostly those companies, you know, they don't want to be messing about cutting things individually because they make hundreds of things. But obviously, for us guys who are doing stuff at home, we don't have that. You know, we don't have that luxury. So. That's about as close as you can get to speeding it up, really. So, right, I'll just cut this shape out now. Obviously, you don't need to watch me cutting it out. It's just a question of Stanley knifing it out carefully. Okay, that's most of the shape cut out. I've just left these corners because I've mentioned this before, but I want to tell you again. When you're cutting out a small round corner like that, rather than trying to drag your knife around in a curve, which is very awkward, just cut the corner off in a series of straight cuts. Maybe four or five straight cuts like that, and you'll get yourself a nice round corner. And once you've beveled and burnished that, you'll never know that you cut it in straight bits. It's miles easier to do that than it is to try and turn a sharp knife around a corner like that. It really is. Okay, so that's it cut out. Now there is excess on this pattern. Okay. That isn't. We're going to basically cut off and waste some of this leather, which is a necessity when you're doing, you know, the wet forming or folded kind of pouches. If you're making like a stacked dagger pouch, like we've done on some other videos, then obviously you can work out what size the piece needs to be, cut it to the right size initially, and then you're done. With something like this, you need to allow excess so that once it's all wet and folded and dried and baked and everything, then you can cut off the bits that you don't need. If you try and make it the right size initially, you're always going to end up having too little leather, and then it's no good, you know. So if you end up wasting a couple of thin strips, it really doesn't matter. Some just before we go any further with this as well, I'll talk about what type of leather this is quickly. I'm not going to get into this in great detail because it could, you know, I could sit and talk for an hour on it on its own. All these sheaths that I'm making in these videos and items are made from full grain leather. Full grain leather means that it's the only leather that's come off the animal. That's as opposed to like split leather, where they take a piece of leather like this and basically split it down the middle, refinish the crappy half at the bottom and sell that as something else. That's the kind of thing that you get on cheap settees and stuff. Full grain leather means it's the full thickness with all the strength in and the, you know, the nice skin side and everything. You want full grain leather for any leather stuff you're doing like that. It's vegetable tanned leather, which means it's been tanned using, you know, sort of bark and tree and plant extracts and bits and pieces. That's as opposed to like chrome tanned leather, which is used in shoes, which is not what you want for sheath making stuff. And weight wise, it depends on what I'm doing, but all the main sheaths are made from 3 to 3.5 mil leather, which is like 8 to 9 ounce if you're using the ounces system, which makes no sense to me whatsoever. And if I'm doing thinner stuff like accessories, then it's usually going to be like 2 to 2.5 mil stuff, which would be like 6 to 7 ounce on the ounces system. So basically, you want full grain, veg tanned, and then whatever thickness you want. In terms of the cut, these are from shoulders. You can also use like sides and stuff, but generally if you want to do tooling and you want it to be relatively rigid, which you do usually for sheaths, obviously you want that supporting structure there, then shoulders is the cut that you want. Okay, so full grain, veg tanned shoulders, 2 to 2.5 mil, 3 to 3.5 mil. You, when you go onto the websites and stuff to buy the leather, you're going to see all sorts of offers of bits and pieces that, you know, they're selling cheap, and it's going to say, like, you know, buffalo belly at £2.50 a square foot. And you're going to look at the shoulders and you're going to go, well, hang on, that's £8 a square foot. I'm just going to get some buffalo belly or something. You know, you need to use the right stuff. It's no use buying cheap, crappy stuff that they're selling off that's in some weird pre-dyed colour that's from the wrong part of the animal and everything like that, because you're just going to be disappointed with what you've made if you get the wrong stuff. So anyway, that's what you want. Decent quality, veg-tanned, full-grain shoulders, okay? Where you get it in your individual countries, I've got no idea. In the UK, if you go to my website, there's a big section of links. There's loads of leather shops on there. So, let's get cracking with this. So we've cut this out. As I say, we've left excess on the pattern. There's extra length on this fire steel holder. There's extra, basically, on the sides that there needs to be. This collar is the size that it needs to be. I've obviously worked that out previously to be the right size, so this isn't going to be trimmed. So the next thing to do is going to be... Oh, I'll tell you what I've also done. I've marked the centre line down the back there. We'll get to that in a second. I need to trim, if I can find the right beveler, the all the way around the outside of this. If you trim around any corners and looking a bit too square, make sure you just take an extra tiny bit off to keep your corners nice and round. Obviously your inside corners, that's a lot easier. It's your outside corners where you can occasionally go across a bit square. I'm going to flip it over. I'm going to do the same on the inside. I'm not going to bevel the full length, on the inside, because this is going to be close together. You don't want to bevel the insides of edges that you're closing together, because you're going to get like a gap. So I'm just going to go maybe a couple of centimetres away from where it turns into the collar, and I'm just going to bevel this inside. One other thing that I wanted to talk about, sorry, this isn't very organised, is it? One other thing that I wanted to talk about in terms of leather quality and how you can tell whether you've got crappy leather. I got some leather delivered the other week, which was absolutely rubbish. It was so bad that I actually sent it back to the shop, which is something I've never done before with leather. But I was so unhappy with it when it arrived that I said, you know, this, I had like 20 square feet of it. And I said to myself, I'm just not making 20 square feet worth of stuff. That's like 20 sheaths or something with this crappy leather. This is a piece of it that I've got left over. Often, if you look on the skin side of leather, it's got a little bit of test stamping on, ignore that. If you look on the skin side of leather, it might not look too bad. On the skin side, you're looking for kind of scars and things like that. If you get leather that's got, I mean, all leather has marks on it, or most leather has marks on it, because obviously, you know, the cows will brush up against barbed wire fences, or they'll get, you know, tick bites or fly bites, and that makes little imperfections on the surface. That doesn't bother me at all, because it's come from an animal. It should look like it's come from an animal. It, to me, if you get little scars and things on it, it's almost just more interesting, to be honest. It makes it more unique. So, you know, that doesn't bother me. If you were making sort of, you know, belts or purses to sell in some sort of leather boutique in Milan or something, then yes, you're going to be bothered about scars on. But for making knife sheaths, which people are going to, you know, the kind of people who are buying them are outdoorsy people who enjoy bushcraft and camping and things like that. They're not going to be bothered about, you know, little tiny scars and marks. If anything, they're like me, they'll find it interesting. Plus, it's going to pick up marks when you're doing sort of outside stuff anyway. So, you know, as long as it's not got huge gouges in and things, that's fine. I'm not bothered about little marks. But in terms of the rest of the quality of it, you want to be looking at the flexibility of it. If it feels too stiff and cardboardy, as in it's not got the right oils and treatment in, that's a sign that there's something wrong with it. A really good sign of crap leather, or a good way of finding crap leather, is by looking at the flesh side rather than the skin side. Okay, this here is a nice piece of leather, and you can see that on the, hopefully you can see on the camera, on the flesh side of it here, it's quite smooth. The grain of the flesh side of it is nice and tight. When I've obviously run the beveler down it there, the beveler hasn't made like a scratching sound or anything. It's gone through it, you know, quite buttery. It's nice and tight, and it'll burnish well. If you look at the back of this by comparison, it looks like chipboard. Okay, it's rough. It's rough to the touch. You can see that it's very sort of scratchy and hairy. And I can tell you from experience that the grain of this is too loose. So when I've beveled this, which it doesn't bevel easily, and you try and do a burnish on the edge, all you're doing is rubbing up like a mushy mound of leather, rather than it taking a nice burnish, and that's because this is all too loose. Okay, now if you buy some shoulders or something, you might expect a bit of leather like this at the very edges, you know, where it's coming towards the edges, but you should expect a good usable section in the middle. The leather that I bought like this, the whole thing was crappy like that. So just bear in mind, if you do buy some leather, this is, you know, this is what you're looking for. Nice and supple. Feels nice and tight grain on the flesh side, which is what you want. Now the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to actually do sort of a half burnish on this edge, which I've beveled. Now the reason I'm doing that is once you actually fold this round and create that collar, it's very, very difficult to get any sort of burnishing in there, and you're trying to sort of almost burnish with your fingertips, which is very difficult. If you kind of start it off now with a normal burnishing tool like you would any straight edge, then it makes the job a lot easier to just sort of then finish it off later on. So I'll just dampen that down, find the burnishing tool. These burnishing tools that Tandy sell are brilliant, by the way. They're a lot easier to use than the wheels, because you can get a proper grip on this. And they're only about £10. I highly recommend these. They've got different sized grooves in them, you know, for different weights of leather. And you just sort of get the right groove, and you basically just give it a rub. Doesn't take much at all to start getting an edge on. If anybody's watching this thinking, well, when you dye the edge now, it's not going to take the dye properly. As long as you don't burnish it too much, it will still take a dye. Obviously not quite as well, but I think it's more important to have maybe a slightly lighter edge that's burnished properly than a properly dyed edge, which you can't get a good burnish on. So, you know, it doesn't matter too much if it's a little bit lighter anyway. It just adds to the visuals of it. So that's just started that off. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to groove the back as well. This is the centre line down the back of the sheath. Now this is a difference that you'll see on the older video. If I was doing that, you'd watch me groove that straight down the centre line. Trick that I've learned from reading the Bob Lovelace books is if you actually groove to either side of your centre line and put two grooves in, then it folds through a right angle better. And I've tried this on the last sheath that I did, and it does work miles better. So I'm going to come sort of maybe 5 millimetres or so either side, and I'm going to actually draw two additional lines either side of the centre line, only down to the bottom, and they're going to be like the lines that I groove. When I do the grooving, I'm not going to groove right off the front end of here, because you're going to see that, you know, where the collar is. So I'm going to start just slightly back, and then simply just groove down. There we go. So what we've actually got there is essentially what will form like almost like a top spine to the sheath, and then just a groove either side. And just tidy up that bottom edge. Okay, so this is now ready for us to actually get wet and wet foam around the knife. Now the reason we're wetting the leather is obviously so that we can bend it. Obviously if you've done any leather, that's going to sound obvious to you, but if you're starting out, you might think why we're wetting this leather. Leather when it's dry like this is only so flexible, and it doesn't hold its shape. The key property to leather that lets you make sheaths like these is that when you wet it and fold it into a shape, then when it dries, it holds. Yeah, so we're going to wet this down, and then that's going to allow us to actually form it to the knife. Now, because this isn't my knife, it's a German man's knife, what we're going to do is actually put cling film around this to keep it nice and dry. If you're dealing with any sort of high carbon steel knives, it's a good idea to do this anyway, just so they don't get too wet. But I do this as a matter of course with anybody else's knife. Make sure it's squashed into all the just the contours there, so we can get the tools into the contours, and then that's now nice and protected. So in terms of wetting the leather, I've read all sorts about this, you know, like for how long you need it in there, how hot the water needs to be, and all crap like this. Basically, the water doesn't need to be very hot, and it doesn't need very long. All right, I've seen people say, well, I'll soak it for half an hour. You don't need to soak leather for half an hour to do this. It needs like 20 seconds, if anything, and it'll be absolutely fine. It's going to start to get really mushy if you soak it unbelievably. Pop it in both sides just so you see the bubbles come out, and then you'll basically have some wet leather. So the next thing I'm going to need once I've done that is the board. This is the board that I use to make the sheaths on. There's absolutely nothing special about it. It's just a piece of board. What I have done with it though is I've rounded the edge. Okay, like at this side you can see that's got a square edge on because it's like, you know, it's cut pine. On this edge I've actually sort of rounded the edge off. The reason I do that is if you put the wet leather against a sharp edge like that, square edge, you'll find it actually sort of make a line in the leather that'll stay there. So, you know, just take the board, and all I've done is I've just rounded that off with a Stanley knife, and that way it keeps any sharp edges away from the wet leather and stops you making lines in it. The reason that I'm going to use a board is it's going to be actually stapled to the board once it's sort of had its rough shape made, and that just keeps everything together and nicely in line, ready for going in the oven, which we'll talk about in a minute. For stapling, you want a fairly heavy duty staple gun, because obviously it's going to have to go through you know, at least 6 or 7 mil of leather, and then into wood as well. Okay, so I'm going to go wet this leather. As I say, 20 seconds, 30 seconds in warm water, that's all it needs, and then we'll come back and see how we actually form. Okay, so that's the leather that's wet there. Before you start doing any sort of wet moulding like this, try and make sure you've got clean hands, as clean as you can, clean as a leather worker's hands are getting, because obviously mine have got bits of dye on and stuff, but clean as you can with your hands, short fingernails, okay, because if you start digging fingernails into this, you're going to make little fingernail marks all over it, and they're just not going to come out. You can't really rub out a fingernail mark, so, you know, ladies especially, you know, if you want to give into this craft, you might have to forego the fancy fingernails. Blokes, you just have short fingernails anyway, because long fingernails are manky, so just get your fingernails cut. Okay, so now, time to get the knife in this. Now, if you've watched the other video, you'll see that the way I did these initially was going to be to lay the piece like that, put the knife on it, fold it over, and essentially the back side was flat, the front side was moulded. Now, the reason I did that was because these are essentially scout carry things to go on the small of your back. Primarily, that's what they are. And my feeling was that, obviously, if you made the back side flat, it kind of sits against your back a bit better. And it's less lumpy, you know, because you've got a little bit more of a flat there. I think aesthetically and in terms of the retention on the sheath and everything, that's probably not the best way to do that. So the way that I do these now is to actually get the knife centred up in the sheath and mould it on both sides. It's obviously a little bit more work, but I think it's better that way. So the first thing I'm going to do before I put the knife is, and I'm just going to fold the knife in half like you would if you were doing something with paper. Fold the leather in half. I do talk some bollocks when there's a camera there, you know, and it's only because I'm concentrating. This is a proper project, remember, that we're filming here. It's not just for the sake of this video. Okay, I'm just going to sort of pre-squash that down in half. You'll see how easily that folds now that's wet. You know, if that was dry leather, that would just be cracking and such. I'm going to place the knife in. Now, in terms of front to back placement, remember where there's this little divot in the handle here, that's all that we've got to get a good grip on with the retention strap. The retention strap is going to be in the middle of the collar, so it's very, very important to make sure that the divot in the handle is lined up with the middle of the collar, and that way when the strap comes around, it's gripping the right place. You also obviously need to make sure you've got enough handle to grab and pull this out. The way these sheaths are, they cover the majority of the knife up, so you really only need, it's not like trying to come out of a horizontal sheath where you have three fingers to pull to come out of these sheaths because of the design of them. It really is kind of a side of the finger and thumb pull to extract the knife. So yeah, make sure you can see that the blade is lined up basically on that, in between those two channels that we made, and then I've got the dip in the handle lined up with the collar, so that I know I've got it centred front to back, centered side to side, essentially. And then all I'm going to do is you can see I'm pinching on the handle there with my fingers to keep that right. And all I'm then going to do is just start to work with my fingers that sheath closed around the knife, always making sure that I've got some pressure on the handle here so that this knife isn't moving around in any way. And I'm going to start to get an initial wet forming on that just with my fingers. That's all I'm using at the start. Keep turning it this way and that so that you can see that it's lined up. If it's not lined up, twist it, line it back up, you know. Don't just look at one side. Your fingers. This section here, now you're not expecting this to line up perfectly on the edge, that's okay, that's just because of the way that the leather is going to naturally bend, that's fine. But make sure that it's straight here, these two pieces are together. You know, it's basically going to lose, front to back, it's going to lose its alignment because obviously the knife's thicker in some places than others. Once you've kind of squashed that with your fingers a bit, got that nicely lined up, got that front edge lined up, basically then I'm going to start moulding it to the handle a little bit. So I'm going to take this, which we use for burnishing, which also doubles up as a modelling tool, and I'm just going to start to work with that a little bit around the bottom of the handle there to push the handle in. If you haven't got one of these, you can take any of your you know, your edge bevelers and stuff like that and use the round part of the handle and do the same thing like this and push around. You don't need a special tool. And you're not trying to really carve the outline of the handle or anything here. You know, like you would if you're doing a little sort of Spyderco friction pouch where you get all the contours. You're literally just working the leather in around the handle. Turn it over, same thing on the other side. Sometimes I use both this, I kind of use the point of this a bit more, and then so it doesn't leave too much of a groove there, I'm actually just smoothing that back in with the handle of the tool as well. And end on, you can see that that's now forming that in there. You can see without me really doing anything, it's starting to come in and grip that handle on its own. So just work that a few times. As I say, it doesn't need to be, you know, really carved out. It just needs to be sort of encouraged to grip the handle, if you like. Both sides. Okay. Once that's gripping like that, then at the front here, where the handling inside drops down to the blade, you want to get in this section as well, so that when you push the knife in, it kind of naturally finds the end of the handle pocket rather than trying to push too far down into the sheath, and then you've got the blade poking into the well. You want it to kind of stop here. So feel with your finger where the end of the handle is, and just start to again work around just with the tools. I tend to get terrible cramp in my hand when I'm doing this. I don't know why. It's very awkward. Just working around with the tools like that. You can use your thumb as well. You know, get your thumb in there, push with the edge of your thumb, and then just try and join these two. I try and just join these two around. Just pull the whatever tool you're using. Just pull it down and around to actually then sort of just suggest the shape of the full shape of the handle. Again, feeling where the front of the blade is there. Okay, once you've gone over both sides and you've kind of got the shape of the handle going on there, it's at that point that I then staple this down to my board. So I'm going to place it on my board. Turn my board upside down. I'm just going to make sure that I've got as much of it on as I can without pushing into the area there that I've moulded. And then well away from where we're actually, you know, right on this edge that we're going to cut off. Just going to whack in. Five or so staples like that. And all that's doing basically is just helping to keep that together. It lets you take your hands off a little bit and flex your hands up, and just lets you keep that shape together. Okay. So once that's on there, just work that slightly more. I keep pinching down here. Remember, we've got two grooves running down there, and we want this to fold over on an angle. So just keep nipping that together and making sure that that's trying to trying to form a square, as it should do, like that. And you can actually turn the whole thing over, just make sure that's looking okay there. Once you've done that bit, it's time to make the collar try and fit to the knife a little bit better. So what we do there is make sure we're gripping it. Take the flat part of the tool and I actually rub up and down the top of the handle there so that we're actually pushing the leather down so that it meets the top of the handle. Keep making sure it keep it squeezed. If you're doing this bit right and pushing that down, you should find that as you get to the end of where the handle is here, where you've formed in your little ramp that goes up there, that's because you've actually squashed that fold down against the knife, which is what you want. Keep that gripped. And then basically just push with your fingers in and make sure that this collar is gripping as best as it can around the handle. There's going to be a strap, remember, so it's not, you know, it's not a friction sheath as such, but I'd like to think on these that if the strap got knocked open by accident, the knife wasn't going to just drop straight out. You know, there should be an extra bit of resistance there. So once that's done, pull the knife out carefully, put it somewhere safe, and then just nip again along there. Now, what we're going to do with this is put it in the oven. Okay, again, the issue or the topic rather of what's called boiled leather, the French name for it's cuir brûlé or something, is the old term for it, but it means boiled leather. You're not actually boiling it anyway. We'll just call it putting leather in the oven, let's call it that, because we don't need to discuss the like medieval history of it at this point. What we're doing essentially is we've wet it, formed it, now we're going to pop it in the oven. That's going to achieve two things for us. First of all, it's going to make the sheath dry quicker, so we can crack on and do the rest of it. If we leave this to dry naturally, it's going to need quite a few days to actually let all that water dry out. If we pop it in the oven, it accelerates the drying, so we can obviously get on quicker. The second thing it's going to do for us, which is the most important thing, is it's going to actually harden the leather more than it would if we let it dry naturally. The reasons for that are quite complicated. I'm not going into it in detail, but basically leather is a fibrous structure, like a protein structure with lots of little fibres. If you get it wet and then dry it quickly, you kind of set those fibres into like more of like a lattice, and it makes kind of like a rigid lattice structure in the leather, and you can actually make sort of very hard leather items like that. You know, it's not floppy like natural leather like this. It would be hard and it would kind of tap to the touch. And it's what they used to use for making armour and things. For our purposes, because we want this, we don't want this section here around the handle too squashy, so it loses its shape. We want it fairly rigid. It benefits us to do that. In terms of time and temperature and things, it obviously depends on your oven, it depends on the leather you're using, it depends how wet you got it. For me, I use the lowest temperature setting on my normal oven downstairs. I haven't got like a desktop oven or anything like that that some people have. It goes in the normal oven, you know, that you put pies in, because in Yorkshire we like pies. The lowest temperature you've got on that is 50 centigrade. No idea what that is in Fahrenheit, I don't do Fahrenheit. 50 centigrade. Okay, that's had in the oven at about 50°C. That's been in there for, I think, probably about an hour and 20 minutes altogether. It's going to depend, you know, on various things, how long it needs to be in there, but generally between about an hour and a quarter and an hour and a half at 50°C, I tend to find works. Now, it doesn't stay in there just sort of cooking away all that time. It needs a bit of, it needs a bit of tending. Now, what I do is it goes in for about 20 minutes, then I take it back out, put the knife back in, and just go over the moulding again. Take the knife out, put it back in the oven for about another 20 minutes. Take it out, go over the moulding again. I do that about three times. So basically, for the first hour, it comes out a couple more times and goes over the moulding. Then after it's had about an hour, it's basically a question of popping it in for 10 minutes, taking it out, putting it in for 10 minutes, taking it out, just keeping an eye on sort of how dry it's getting. The aim with it isn't to kind of bake it to death like it would be for some proper boiled leather. It's just a question of sort of firming it up You know, so it doesn't want to look completely dry and shriveled up and everything like that, because it's going to start to shrink anyway. But you should be able to feel by squeezing this top section that, you know, it shouldn't feel too squashy. It should feel fairly rigid. When you can start to see sort of, you know, this thin strip where the fire steels, I can start to see that drying out on the end. So basically, you know, there on the collar as well, it's just starting to dry out. It's lighter than the rest of it. So basically, when it starts to go where it will be getting very dry, that's the time to bring it out while the rest of this is still a bit damp, rather than leaving it in there until it goes, you know, very, very dry. So, once that's come out, the next thing to do is to actually trim off the excess that's on here. Now, I have a welt template to go with my main template, so this is easy for me. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and sort of tell you the measurements a little bit. Obviously, if you're working on different knives or you're working this out for yourself. So I know from experience that on an F1, on this template where I've got the fire steel coming in, I need just basically a very small corner just under the fire steel. And then I just lay the welt template across and make sure that the top of the sheath here is parallel with the welt template there. Which, these are a very handy thing, these gauges. I think everybody should have one of these in a leather shop, because they're very useful just for keeping an eye on how straight things are and how wide things are and so on. That's nicely lined up. And I'm simply then just going to mark straight across the bottom. Don't take any notice of this outside edge as a line, because it's going to be all, because of the way it's come over the handle, it's going to be out of line. You need to be looking at the top edge there. So I've now got a nice straight line between those there and coming in here. Now, if you're working this out for yourself and you need to know how much distance you need, basically where the knife comes in here, you need a little bit of area to flex to let the knife in, and then below that area you need enough distance to actually get the welt in. So the thinnest part of this welt here, notice it obviously thickens up, but the thinnest part of that welt there, I imagine it's about 12 millimeters. So I've got a 12 millimeter welt, and then if I pop that against the leather there, so you can see that above, basically as this is curved around the handle, there's maybe the same distance again above there, in terms of, as a sort of flexing distance, if you like, where this has come together. So if you wanted a rough idea, see where your sides come in and actually meet together under your handle, and then you want to allow about 24 mm, which is actually about an inch if you're working there, and then that goes straight across. So this can now be cut. Bearing in mind, I'm just going to put the lamp on. Bearing in mind this is still wet and everything, so we're not going to do much more with this until it's dried, but it can be cut out. When I cut this out, it allows it to open up slightly and get some air in and just get drying inside. If I was to leave this closed up for days, then the inside of it will actually struggle to dry. You're not going to be able to go through all of that leather in one go with a knife, so just carefully start to get a score across, and you're going to have to just follow that score a few times. Obviously keeping the knife nice and straight and watching your fingers. And just go through until you feel that you're all the way through. And that's the sheath off. And that there on the board is the amount of leather that we've wasted, essentially. When I said we're going to waste a couple of strips of leather, that's the amount that we've got there. It's not a lot of leather, as you can see, it's just a couple of little bits. Don't keep these, because they're not good for anything. Just get them in the bin. Unless you want to do some dyeing tests or something. Flip that over. As I say, this is right-handed, so that's actually the front side of the sheath. And that now there has given us the basic shape of the sheath that we're gonna have. Obviously, this loop's going to be folded over. I'll just leave that sticking out for now. What we can do actually at this point is dye the sheath, and then it will be left to dry for probably at least 24 hours before I do anything else with it, if not slightly longer, but usually a day. The reason I'm going to dye this now is because it's still damp and damp leather will accept the dye better, especially when it's been baked a little bit like this. When we start to dye this, you'll see that it doesn't accept the dye nearly as nicely as a piece of unbaked leather would. The act of doing the sort of the tooling and the baking hardens up certain areas, and it makes the dye go on a lot more unevenly. You can still get a nice finish on it, it just needs a couple more coats. So we'll actually go ahead and dye this now. In terms of this pre-cut welt template, which I will obviously be using for the welt for this, I will actually show you later on how to measure the welt yourself so that it works for any different knives as well. So don't worry about the fact that this is all... I don't need to look at this and think he's got a template. I can't do it without a template. We'll show you how to actually make the correct welt shape as well. So we'll dye this now. Now, a sheath like this that you're working on, if you've taken a bit of leather off a hide and you've not really messed about doing a lot of tooling and your hands are clean, I don't think it needs any sort of dye prep or deglazer or anything like that. I used to use dye prep and things, and I'm not so sure it achieves a whole lot on leather like this. If you do excessive tooling and get a lot of oils out of your hands onto leather, then some dye prep can help, but certainly with a sheath like this where we've not really done anything to it other than just wet it and bend it, I don't think it's necessary. So we will go ahead and just dye straight onto this. Fibbins professional oil dye in dark brown. Just double check on my order sheet that is right. Yeah, dark brown. Always, if you're making sheaths for other people, always double check your dye colour before you dye it, because I've dyed things the wrong colour before, and inevitably, if you contact somebody and say, "I've accidentally dyed your sheath the wrong colour, do you want this other colour?" they always say, "No, I really wanted it dark brown." And you end up carrying on with that sheath and selling that separately or something, which is okay. To be honest with you, everybody wants everything dark brown as well. I've got so many colours of leather dye up there. I must have 8 or 10 different colours and about 5 different antique stains and all things. And all anybody ever wants is dark brown. I go through so much dark brown dye. But if that's what people want, then that's fine. So we'll just get the inside of there first. No need to dye all the inside of the sheath, really, When somebody first gets a sheath, they might sort of peer down inside it slightly, but nobody's ever going to really look at the inside of a sheath too much, so no need to dye all the inside if you don't want. It's only dye to come off, but it's up to you. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. Get the edges first, though. Around there. The edges here. As you can see, that's accepting dye fine on that edge, even though we burnished it slightly as well. Just get the mouth of the sheath just there. Just the entrance there. As you can see, all that inside doesn't really need dyeing there. Just you'll just see the mouth of it there. That's fine. And once we've got the inside of there and got the edges there, the main sheath can be dyed. Now, as I say, when this dye goes on, you're going to look at it and think, "Ooh, that's not going on very well," because it's been baked. As I say, it will need usually a few applications. Go straight down the spine of the thing there. You can obviously dip dye sheaths, if you've got a massive container full of dye and you want to just dip it in, then go ahead and dip it in. You need to be buying a lot of dye to do that, though, like gallon containers or something. Most people don't have the amount of dye to be dip dyeing, frankly, so you can see there where that's been rubbed, it's a lighter colour, the dye hasn't gone on as well, it looks all blotchy on that side. That's because it's got one coat on. That's what dye looks like with one coat. It's not a one coat application usually. So once we've done that, I'll go this on in straight lines. Now, you might be thinking, when's the logo going on as well? Because I'm dyeing ordinarily. If I was using flat pieces to make a dagger sheath or something, I would have actually cased it and done the logo by now. This is still too damp to put the logo on. I know from experience the logo won't go on crisply. So we'll actually re-dampen a small square later on and put the logo on. And I think I need to put initials on this one as well from memory. And you know, leather dye doesn't need to be a perfect finish either. It's not, you know, it's a natural product to me. It doesn't need to look, you know, like if you get a piece of micarta or something like that and it looks all like solid black or solid brown. Leather's not supposed to look like that. Cows aren't one colour. You know, your own skin isn't one colour. It varies, you know, so it's, to me, it just enhances the fact that it's a natural product if there is some slight variety and shade in it. It's, you know, if you get leather that looks a very solid colour, then it starts to look a bit unnatural sometimes. So, okay, so this will be the third application of dye. That's what I would do normally, is three applications on something like this. I'll go away and come back to it. I haven't actually had my tea yet tonight, so I'll have my tea. I'll come back to it after tea, and if it needs another application, then I'll do another application. In Yorkshire, by the way, when I say tea, I don't mean a cup of tea. I mean like my tea as in what I'm eating when I get in from work. That's what you call your tea. Some people call it dinner. Not in Yorkshire, it's called your tea. So, there we go. And what I will do with that is I'll just actually stand that on end like that, open it up slightly and let it stand on end like a little tent. So that it's not laid down flat. Let the dye soak in there. I'll come back to it. If it looks patchy, it'll have another coat. If it doesn't look patchy, then that's fine. It can stay like that. And basically, that's going to sit there now until probably tomorrow when I get back from work, and then we can carry on and start to get the next stages done. As far as I'm concerned, the hard part of this is done. The hard part of it is cutting your pattern out to the right size, which is obviously easy with your templates, getting your wet forming done, getting your dye on and everything. Once you've done that, really, you know, there's very little space to make a mistake, because, you know, with the correct tools, the stitching's easy enough to do, the straps are easy enough to add, because I'll show you how to do that. Forming the fire steel loop isn't hard, sizing the welt isn't hard. You know, that's all very doable. Once we've got this basic shape, then we shouldn't really make any mistakes from here on in. If you've made a mess of it at this point and the knife doesn't fit properly, then you know it's no good. So hopefully this has been helpful so far. We'll pick this up tomorrow and start to make it look like an actual sheath with some stitching and so on. Okay, here's the sheath that we were working on yesterday. This has had a full day to kind of dry out a bit. The only thing that I've done with this off the camera is just give it a quick buff, just to make sure that the dye's off there, any dye on top, just to bring up the colour. As you can see, it's come up a nice colour, nice dark brown colour. If you leave a sheath like that to dry, you'll find that it kind of crinkles slightly at the edges and bows slightly. That's fine, because as soon as you start to actually put the welt in and sew everything down and get everything into shape, it's gonna drop back into a nice square shape. So, the next thing to do with this is just going to be to actually put the stitch line in. And then we can start to measure where the straps and everything are going, and also there's some stamping that needs doing. There we go, really need to tidy up in here. So the stitch line wants to be on this thinnest part of the welt. It wants to be about halfway up, which is going to be about six millimetres. So the best thing to do to check that you've got your stitch line right with your stitch marker is just to actually take a scrap piece of leather, mark where you want your stitch line to be. I'm going to mark that at 5 millimeters. Mark a line there, and then what you can do is just loosen off your groover, not stitch marker. I'm talking about, and just actually line that up to your line, tighten that up, and then just make sure that you're actually basically removing the line that you've just drawn. And if you are, you know, you've set the distance right before you start working on your actual item. The stitch groove is going to be made on the front side of the sheath. This is a right-handed sheath, so this is the front side, and then it'll be made on the back later on. So simply gonna come when you need to do a corner, it's best not to start on the corner, because if you start too far down, you'll find that the lines don't meet. So I'm going to start slightly higher up than I need to do, and I'm just going to come up to the top of the sheath that way. And then I'm going to come down the front again. I'm starting slightly further away from where I need to be. All the way down the front. And now, as these lines come together now, I can see at what point the lines are going to cross. Make sure that I stop there. And you can see that there's then a little extra bit there, which you can then just join up. And that way you know that everything joins up together. Same thing on the front. I normally just have one stitch going up on the front just to help nip the front up on these. And then once you've got all the lines in, I generally go over these twice with a bit more pressure just to actually get the groove going then. Making sure to go slowly at the ends so you don't actually run off the end of the sheath. There we go. And just try to get any small bits out. So there's the stitch groove. When I make these bushcraft sheaths, there's various different ways of attaching the straps. Sometimes the straps are removable, sometimes the straps are attached to the sheath. If the straps are removable, then there will be two holes put through the welt, and those holes will be measured so that they're in the middle of the welt away from the inside edge, and then the straps you can use Chicago screws and actually screw the straps down, and then the straps are removable. If you look on the website, there's plenty of pictures so you can see what I mean. On this particular sheath, the customer's chosen the attached straps, which is the same style of straps, but the straps are actually riveted on the end to the sheath rather than being removable. That just keeps everything together, and it's slightly tidier in some regards, and it's just a choice what people want to do. When I use the separate straps, which are removable, so you've got holes in, I put two stitch lines in. So there's an outer stitch line which binds the edge of the sheath, and then there's an inner stitch line which follows the welt. So if you imagine the welt's there, the second stitch line would leave the first stitch line, it would come to the inside of this curve here, there would then be a straight section parallel to the outside one, and then when you get to where the welt drops down there, it would drop down and join the other stitch line, so there would be a second stitch line. When you rivet the straps on, you can't put that second stitch line in. The reason being that you can't get in to sew behind it properly and get in to put the holes in properly. So for a sheath where the straps are attached, I generally put an extra couple of rivets in. So there'll be a rivet at the front there and a rivet towards the back there. And obviously with the glue, that's achieving the same thing in terms of keeping that sheath together and keeping the welt nice and tight. It's a little bit more aesthetically better if you have the second stitch lining, but as I say, you can't really do it with the attached straps. One of the problems with leather is this kind of construction order and the correct way in which you have to put things together. Sometimes some things just aren't possible because leather has to go in front of other leather, then you can't get behind it and so on, and it's sometimes just a bit of a compromise. So for this particular sheath, that's the only stitch line that will be on there. The next thing to do is going to be to actually mark the location of the straps. Now the straps on these I space in a particular way so that if people want to attach them to the molly system on rucksacks, they can do. The molly system, you'll see it on Kifaru gear, Maxpedition gear, military gear and things like that. It's the little system of nylon straps which are sewn in a kind of grid pattern, and that lets you actually attach pouches and other things to the rucksacks and so on. The molly is laid out in a standard pattern which allows you to do standard spacing. You can see on this, if you can do this diagram that I have in my little notebook here, a standard molly kind of square, if you like, is an inch by an inch and a half. So you have a grid of inch by inch and a half. Because it's inch and a half wide, that means your centres are an inch and a half. Okay, so your straps need to be on inch and a half multiples apart. So you can see there, look, I've got like inch and a half, 3 inches, 4.5 inches, 6 inches, and you would go on to make sure that the straps dropped into the centre. So for a sheath like this, it would be this distance here, which is 4.5 inches. And the easiest way that I do that is to actually just set the gauge so that I know I've got the right distance. Move those to the side now, and then I know that that distance is the correct distance for the straps. and then I set the distance on the sheet. I need to make sure that the distancing is pretty much sort of equidistant from the front and the back. Certainly there needs to be space at the front to get the front section of stitching in, and at the back there wants to be a little bit of space there to actually get that rear rivet in for grabbing hold of the of the welt. So I just adjust the position slightly to make sure that it's where I want it. The strap I use is a strap that I just cut myself, and I cut it at 22mm, so I can also just check that I've got enough distance there for the sewing by placing that against there, and that looks fine. And then I'm simply going to mark the distances there. I'm just going to put small marks just against the sheath there in case the pen rubs off or I accidentally dye over the pen. Often I've put marks on things and then you go over it with some more dye and your marks have disappeared, so it's often just worth putting actually a small scratch mark as well. So that's set the distances there. With the positions of the straps marked, the next thing that I need to do, which you don't really need to see because it's just a bit of stamping, is to actually put the customer's initials on and my logo on the back, so I'll do that now. That's the logo applied. If you're interested in these leather stamps, there's another video on the channel all about these designing and getting these stamps made and everything, so you can watch that. We'll not go into that now. That just leaves the initials just to add to the front. Okay, that's my logo applied to the back and the initials applied to the front. A little bit of backgrounding around the initials as well, which was requested. Now the next thing for this, ordinarily if you're obviously doing this from scratch, would be to actually make the welt. Now I've obviously got a welt template for this, so I've actually pre-cut the welt and this is the welt that we'll be using. But what I said to you was, I'll show you how to actually you know, work out the welt for yourselves if you're doing this yourselves, or if you're doing this obviously for different knives. So what you will do when you get to this stage is put the knife in the sheath, still got cling film around this as well. You know, while you've got obviously, you know, different dyes and things around and finishes and things like that, it's best just to leave that knife in cling film until you've finished, just to stop any spillages or anything. So you put the knife in the sheath, make sure you've got the knife sort of in the home position where it would sit. I'm going to try and do this side on, so hopefully you can see this on the camera. Place it down carefully so the knife hasn't moved. Carefully open up the side of the sheath. What you want to do is take a pen and just away from where the blade is, you're going to want to draw on the inside of the sheath the shape of the welt. Okay, so we're going to follow the edge of the knife. I'm trying to do this so you can see as well. Follow the edge of the knife, not right up to the edge of the knife, leave a couple of, you know, small gap, and just follow that around. And then you can take the knife out. And what you should have there on the inside of the sheath is a sort of red outline of where the knife goes. Obviously, making sure that you've curved that down at the start for that flexing gap that we talked about. Don't follow the handle too closely. You want to curve that down. But certainly where the blade is, we've followed that. What you will do then is you need to take a piece of tracing paper, same as you would, you know, for tracing pictures. Put the tracing paper inside the sheath, take a pen again, mark the outline of the sheath through the tracing paper, like that, and then where you've drawn that red line, follow that red line with your pen. And take that away. What that's going to do is that's going to give you the shape of the welt. Now, obviously, when you actually cut this welt, you need to make sure that these are all square. So you would you know, you would square your lines up, and make sure that you not actually draw anything. Make sure that you've got everything parallel. So take a square bottom line. This line here, this line here, and this line here would all be parallel, so everything's nice and square, and then bring your curves in. Basically, all you need to do with that then is take a piece of leather, stick that down to your leather, and just carve through as you normally would, and that will then transfer that through to your leather. So, as I said, the construction order for these is important. If I was doing a sheath that had separate straps, then you know, I wouldn't need to do the straps at this point. The straps can be done at the end, because these straps are going to be fixed to this sheath. The straps actually need doing next before we do anything else. Even though there's no stitch marks, no sewing, the welt's not stuck in or anything like that, these straps need making completely, finishing off and actually sticking to the sheath. It's a good idea to apply any finishes, or certainly start any finishes that need applying, before the straps are attached, because it can be difficult to get underneath the straps, and you don't want to get little areas underneath your straps if you're doing that where you haven't got any finish, and if it gets water on, it creates a little damp spot and things like that. So what I will do next with this is actually apply some finish. So first off, some Canova cream. I'm actually going to place the knife in the sheath while I apply the finish as well, just so that I've got something to sort of rub against. With the Canova cream, I just tend to try and cover one side at once, fairly liberally, with the cream over, and then sort of just turn the cloth round, so I've got a sort of dry part of the cloth, and then just obviously polish it like you would with any polish. That's the Canova rubbed in. I like the Canova cream as a sort of first thing to apply on after dyeing, because it brings out a nice shine to the leather, and it gives it a good sort of base layer of protection. For an outdoor sheath like this, Canova's no good just on its own, because it doesn't offer much water resistance. You know, you really need some acrylic finishes and things on top, or waxing or whatever. But certainly as a kind of you know, a base application, I think it's good. So with the Canova on there, well rubbed in, just also add some Resoline. And as I say, the Resoline does add really good water resistance. There's a series of videos I did testing all the different finishes. The Resoline came out on top for this sort of water resistance, so that's what I use now. You can watch those videos if you like to see all about that. And again, with all these kind of Resoline and acrylic finishes, you basically apply them fairly liberally. You know, there's no point working it all off before it's even got on there. Fairly liberally, let them dry for a few minutes, and then you can actually buff them then, just to bring it back to a shine. They all dry fairly quickly, do these. Now that Resoline's dried, what I've just done there is taken my welt template, placed it against the inside of the sheath, and I've just drawn round both sides on the inside of the sheath so that I've got an outline of the welt, which is that green line there. Obviously, if you've not got the template and you've already cut the welt how I just showed you, put the actual leather piece in and draw around the inside as well, so that you've got a mark to the inside. That's going to tell us basically where we need to seal the inside of the sheath, which we're going to do now, and also when you come to do your gluing of the sheath, it'll show you the line of where you need to put the glue, so you should make those marks on the inside. For the actual blade pocket and handle portion of the sheath where the welt isn't covering, I'm going to put some tan coat to the inside. Tan coat is good for, I find, the flesh side of leather, just to help seal the flesh side a little bit, so that if you do put the knife in slightly wet, or things like that, it's not going to, you know, then pass through to the sheath too much. It's not a full waterproof finish, isn't tan coat, so it will allow the inside to breathe a little bit, but it should be fine, as I said, just for protecting the inside a little bit there. So again, you apply it the same way, just get some on your cloth. Try and do this way around so you can see. Basically just rub that on the inside fairly liberally, and you just need to allow this to dry. on the inside. It's quite sticky when it's wet, it's Tamco, but it's as soon as it dries, it goes nice and smooth. That Tamco's dried on the inside, so in terms of finishes for now, that's all that needs doing. So some Canorba and some Resilene on the outside, some Tamco on the inside there. And I may put slightly more Tamco around the handle area later as well, but for now I've got to the, you know, obviously once you close this up you can't get to that section anymore, so it needs, you know, it needs doing now. Okay, so the next thing to do is just to size out the straps. So I'm going to temporarily pop the welt in. I'm going to pop the knife in. And I'm going to use a pre-cut strap. Basically, this strap is just cut from the same leather. The welt, by the way, is the same leather. That's just, 3.5mm shoulder. The same as the outside's made from. If you put a very big knife in, like a Woodlaw maybe or something chunky, you might find you need a thicker welt. So you might have to actually laminate two pieces of leather together or use some sole bend or something, but certainly for something F1 sized, the 3.5's fine. This is the same stuff, 3.5mm shoulder. I just run a strap cutter down it and cut loads of strap at once because I go through loads. If you haven't got a strap cutter, obviously you can just use a ruler, but if you're going to cut any amount of strap, I would highly recommend buying a strap cutter because it'll just save you ages. You can cut really accurate straps really quickly rather than messing about with a ruler. So, okay, we need a little belt blank, like so. Now the straps will be attached, I need the knife in actually, the straps will be attached to the front at the bottom, and they'll then wrap right around the sheath, so it's going to be about three times the height of the sheath. First thing I'm going to do is just square the end of the strap off. If you've got a cutting mat like this, by the way, these lines are on it for, you know, just for fancy, you can use them to cut right angles like that by lining things up both ways, quite handy. And just so I know which end is the end that I've done, I'm going to put the chamfers in like that, so that will be the end of that strap. I'm going to place the strap against the bottom of the sheath, and then I'm going to place the belt blank on the back. It's very important when you're using belts with sheaths that you get a belt blank in, you know, so that you've allowed space for that belt. Leather isn't that forgiving in that if you don't use a belt blank and put something, a piece of leather flush to another piece of leather and then try and cram a belt in, it's just not going to go. So you always need to use belt blanks. So place the belt blank against the back of the sheath there, and then I'm basically just going to wrap. I'm going to wrap the. Sorry if I keep lifting this out of the camera. I'm going to wrap the strap over the top of the sheath, over the belt blank at the back, there, round the bottom of the sheath, and up to the top of the sheath. And then we're going to cut that with a little bit of excess. Just make a mark on there. That, and there we go. And you'll see that one of those is slightly longer than the other. The end one's just slightly shorter. You could just measure one slightly longer without wrapping it round again, but it's always best to double check the fit. So basically these now need turning into straps ready to attach. I'm not going to show you every process of making the straps because it's, or I'm not going to talk over it rather, because it's going to be, you know, it's going to be just the same as doing the normal sheath. These are going to get beveled off, dyed, they'll be buffed, the edges will be burnished, there'll be Canorba cream and Resilene put to the skin side, there'll be Tamco put to the flesh side. So basically all the things we've already done to the main sheath will just be done to these straps so that they're finished, and then we can actually rivet them on. Right, that's the straps done. As I say, they've just had all the same steps that the sheath's had so far. You know, they've been cut, dyed, edge beveled, burnished, Canorba cream, Tamco, Resilene. I think it's important to, you know, pay a lot of attention to your straps. Sometimes I see items that people have made and they look like the straps were a bit of an afterthought, and they're maybe, you know, the edges are square cut rather than burnished, and they're maybe, you know, they look a bit added on. Remember that the, you know, like the reins, like a horse's reins, the straps are the part that you're actually going to, you know, your hands are going to be in contact with the most. You know, it's the part that you're going to sort of handle the most for, you know, putting it on and off your belt or for retention straps. So you know, it's good to spend you know, a lot of time on them and make sure that they're right. It's also obviously the outside of the sheath, it's the part that you notice first, and so on. So that, you know, they are very important. Don't rush your straps. So these are now ready to go on the sheath, but before they do that, obviously we need to install the press studs. So to work out where the press studs go, it's just a question of doing that by eye. Line that up with the bottom of the sheath. Obviously the very bottom there is going to have rivets on, so I'm just going to kind of work out where I want these to go, and then just make a mark so that I can see where to do the punching. And these are line 20 snaps, which I use for the closure on the straps, and the main retention strap will be a line 24, which is a heavier duty one. It's just a question of leaving a little gap in between those and getting those lined up. If you're going to install press studs on a strap, I think you should do all the kind of dyeing and finishing and everything before you put the press studs in. That way the dyes and dyeing finishes is nice and even under the press studs. If you install a press stud on a strap and then try and dye around it and finish around it, you'll inevitably end up with kind of darker circles, and you can't actually get in between the press studs properly to do the finishing. So it's best to just do everything before you put the press studs in, really. There's a video all about the Arbor press that you can watch, so I'm not going to go into that in detail here. Suffice to say, the Arbor press makes things a lot easier than setting these things by hand. If you've got the money, because they're very expensive, you can also buy one of the craft tool hand presses that Tandy sell, which they also sell dies for all the different press studs and rivets and things. But they are really expensive. I think the machine itself is about £140, and then the die sets are sort of about £50 or £60. So, you know, if you're working in a professional shop, then they're probably something you can invest in. But for home, they're quite an outlay, really. So I manage with the Arbor press, which is a compromise but makes life a lot easier. To rivet this on, I'm going to be using these medium single cap rivets. You don't need to use the double cap rivets. In fact, you shouldn't use the double cap rivets where you're going to be burying the back of the rivet inside the leather. The single cap rivets have a nice flat back, so when you close that up inside the leather, it's not going to cause any sort of a lump, which is going to force the edges apart. That's just going to get buried nicely inside the leather. So just work out the positions of these. The cap, there's only just room for the caps on these, so they do need to be positioned right on the corners. There we go, that's the holes marked in both of those. So it's just a question of popping the rivets through, popping the strap over the top, popping the caps on. And then again, they'll just be set down on the arm press now. There we go, that's the rivets set there. As you can see, those two medium cap rivets just nicely fit that 22mm strap. You can't really make your straps any narrower than that because the rivets just don't fit. But they fit just nicely there. Unfortunately, these smaller rivets, the small size, don't really go through two layers of 3.5mm. There's not enough poking out, so you do need to use the medium ones. And that's nice and sturdy. And you can see on the inside, the flat bases there are nice and flush, so that when that edge is all closed up, they're not gonna cause any problems at all. They're just gonna disappear into the welt there. So I'll now fit the front strap in exactly the same way, obviously just further down the sheath there. There's both the straps connected now. We won't do anything else with those straps now until everything's actually sewn up, and then they can be actually formed around the sheath and have the end snaps and everything. But for now, they just kind of stick out like that. That's all they do. We need to get the welt glued in, and then we can do the actual stitching and the drilling and such like. Before we do that, though, we actually need to make the fire steel loop. There's two sizes of fire steel that you can get, or common sizes of fire steel. Light My Fire are probably the most popular fire steels, but people do buy blanks and make their own as well. The larger size, which is called the Army model, uses a 9mm striking thing. They also make this one that I think is called a Scout model, and that, as you can see, that's got a much thinner striker. Obviously, if you make a big hole, you can still put the small striker in. If you make a small hole, you can't put the big striker in. So generally, I form around this large fire steel for everything. I don't think you should rely on friction either for these, because as you actually use a fire steel, obviously, you know, it wears down. When you actually, basically, these are like, I think they call them a ferrocerium rod. And what you do to start your fires is you take the angle on the back of your knife, and you actually put the angle 45 degrees to the striker, and then as you strike like this, it brings sparks off, and that's what you use to light your fires. But obviously, as you do that, the rod wears down, so over time these get thinner and thinner and thinner. So if you make a sheath with a fire steel thing, like I've seen on some designs, where basically it just relies on it shoving into a tube and sitting there and friction, over time you're going to find that actually stops working because it'll get too loose. So the way that I design all the fire steel holders that I do, I make it so that the bottom will poke out, as you can see on here. Once that's formed into a loop, the bottom of the rod's gonna poke out, and then you can simply have some shock cord on it. Which loops around the bottom and locks it into place like that, so that it doesn't matter how worn that gets, and it doesn't matter if you use a thinner one, it's the shock cord that's holding it into place, not friction. So that's how I believe they should be designed. So to form this, all I'm going to do is dip that in some water and get that nice and wet. Remember, if we need to bend leather a lot into shape, generally it's going to need to be wet, and then it will hold its shape, and then it's simply a matter of forming the loop around the steel then. Just making sure that it's nice and tight on a fully sized steel. The steel doesn't want to be flopping about too much, it doesn't need any side to side play or anything. It just wants to be nice and tight. Make sure that's free to move. These can be put in different positions as well, you know. The easiest place to put these out of the way is on the end of the sheath, but it can be put here in the middle of the sheath if you want. Or when I do some of the straps, you can basically, if you're using the straps that bolt through, you can leave a loop in the strap as it bolts around, put it in the strap. You know, there's all different places that can go. You can even make something that mounts in the middle here, or wherever you want. It's up to what people want, but generally out of the way on the end of the sheath there is not a bad place for that to go. So that can actually just get cut off straight there. And then that's just the excess, which we don't need. There we go. So what we have to do now is cut a small notch out of the welt to accommodate that fire steel as well, because that needs to be a continuous piece inside. And then just mark on where the extents of the fire steel are there. And that just allows us to mark out a small notch, which we'll need to remove. There we go. And then when that welt goes into the sheath now, that fire steel loop will sit into that notch there, and then when the whole thing closes up together, that'll all now be nice and solid. For the glue, I'm using this EvoStick Time Bond like you've seen before, which is contact adhesive. You can use any contact adhesive that you like. Two-part adhesive, so you know, a lot of leather clafters use barge cement and things like that. Whichever one you want to use, you can use. And then with the contact adhesive, it's just a question of applying it to both of the surfaces that you're going to glue. try and keep it away from the edges if you can, like I've just daubed that edge. Try and keep it fairly away from the edges, but make sure that you're getting a decent coverage on. You don't want it slopping around, but you also don't want, you know, you need to cover every part, so don't put it on too thin. But also, you're not daubing it on too much. Remember, we put that line in before, that green line, so we could see where to glue to as well. Because you obviously don't want glue all on the inside of the sheath, where the knife's going. There we go. Now that needs to be left to dry, the glue, without sticking it together. It needs to be left to dry until it's just what they call touch dry. Which is basically until it doesn't feel sticky. Okay, that's ready to glue together now. So I'm going to put the welt in first. And basically I'm going to make sure I carefully line up the bottom corner there. And I'm just going to make sure the edges are aligned. I'm trying to, if you can see, I'm trying to keep the back of it lifted up while I'm doing this section, so that it doesn't sort of grab in the wrong place while I'm not concentrating on that section. So just try and keep it lifted up with your fingers and then just squeeze it down. And then basically once you've got that back section in, you can then just work along the edge, keeping the edges aligned and just pushing the edges together. It's going to be sanded anyway, but get them as lined up as well as you can now, and then there should be very minimal sanding to do. Once you're happy that the edges are all aligned, just squeeze it together with your fingers, making sure that it's pushed all the way. And then that fire steel loop can be folded into that notch as well, and just pushed down. And you can see that that's nice and tight, there's no big gaps there. Just push that there. Double check that the fire steel will go in, which it will. And then once that's done, you can just do the same thing for the top of this and the inside and get the whole thing stuck together. I've stuck both sides together there. As I say again, you want to hold that end on and just sight your eye down this line here and make sure that it looks straight. If there's any bend to it, just tease it around before it's sewn and make sure that it's as straight as it can be, because obviously the knife's straight, so the sheath needs to follow on to be straight as well. You'll also notice up here where the welt comes up, I've cut the welt short so that there's just a small hole there between the top and the welt, and that's just a little drainage hole, so if this did get full of water for any reason, it should let the water tip out of the bottom there. It doesn't need to be a big hole, and I think it's neater doing that than cutting holes in the back, as I've seen some people do. Just a small hole there. So just make sure it's all squeezed together along the line of the welt, and the best thing to do is something flat, and if you've got one of these rubber hammers, just give the a tap. So with that closed up, we can now make the stitching holes, because we know where all the holes need to go. So I'm going to take a brush, just put water on the brush, and I'm just going to brush water into the groove. If I was to soak this with a wet cloth or something, you're going to start making a kind of different coloured line around the bottom if it picks up any of the water, so it's better to actually brush it in neatly. I know people say that I do things a bit precisely, but that's just the way it goes. Stitch is, for a sheath this size, size 5 stitch marker, that's 5 to the inch. Start on the corner so that you know the stitch is going to be in the corner where it should be, and then just mark the stitches with the wheel as you would. Oh, the sun's come out. That could change. Right on the corner. And just go over it a few times like that so that you make a nice deep stitch bed. And then I'm going to do the same thing just along here and then in here as well. I'm now going to drill straight through all these holes that have been marked on this Dremel workstation with the drill bit. There there's all the holes drilled through, and then on the back side we've now got obviously a series of holes where the drill bits come through. Now I'm not going to get into a big discussion on the merits of, you know, hand punching versus drilling holes. Suffice to say, as far as I'm concerned, on a sheath as thick as this, at 5 to the inch, there's absolutely nothing wrong with drilling your holes. You're not going to perforate the leather or whatever people say, or pull a stitch through. There's absolutely no way you're pulling a stitch through that much leather in between those holes. It's just physically not going to happen. You'd snap the thread even if you could manage to do it. So, you know, there's nothing wrong with drilling your holes like that. If you don't have a drill or you want to hand punch your holes, you can, of course, once your stitches are marked, just get your awl and either push it straight through the leather or tap it through the leather with a hammer, whatever you want to do. But certainly for me, when I can, I drill the holes, because it's a lot quicker, a lot easier, and it just saves a lot of stress, basically. So once the holes are made on the back, it's just a question of then joining up the holes with your groover. If the holes are all consistent, hopefully you should just be able to pull the stitch groover straight down them anyway. When you get to do a series of holes like this, which obviously pass by the fire steel loop, you can't actually pull this down the edge, because it's going to get stuck where that is. So to do that, you need a different tool, which is not a parallel groover. It's just a freehand groover like this. Basically, all you need to do there is just put your ruler on the line just away from the holes, and just pull this in a nice straight line down the ruler. Now those holes have been drilled through, the next thing to do is to actually just wet the groove again, just the same as before, with a bit of water, and then take the stitch groover, checking it's the same size that was used last time, and actually just go back over these holes. And rather than looking like a series of holes, that will start to get them looking like a nice stitch bed. Then just go backwards and forwards a few times with those holes drilled, and the holes gone back over with the overstitch wheel. The last thing to do before this can be sewn is to actually just die the groove now, which is just a case of just carefully brushing in a little bit of the matching dye. This is so you obviously don't see any sort of white natural leather coloured bits around the stitching. Okay, with those dyed in now, this can actually get sewn up. Obviously there's three separate little stitching runs here, rather than being one long stitching run, because it's divided. So it's just a question of stitching in three separate stages. For a sheath as thick as this, I will pull out 5 times the length of each stitching run. So for that middle section, that would be 1, double it over there, that gives you 2, 3, 4, 5. There will be excess on that, and there will be some thread wastage, but you always need to allow extra thread, so that if your needles pull off the end of the thread, you've got some thread left to actually re-thread your needle. Thread is comparatively cheap compared to all your other materials, really. So it's, you know, it's never worth running out of thread, because it's just a nightmare. Trying to finish off a stitching run, if you're running out of thread, it's just not worth it. So just allow yourself extra thread. Putting a lot of effort into something like this, then you really shouldn't be worrying about little bits of thread. This thread here is from Tandy, and it's the pre-waxed nylon thread. Comes in a packet like that. It's 12271, if you're looking it up in the catalogue. Pre-waxed nylon thread. I used to, when I first started, I was using the linen thread and waxing it by hand. But frankly, this pre-waxed stuff is stronger, and it saves all the faffing about waxing it yourself. So this is nicer to use. The downside of it is it only comes in black, brown and white. You can't get like a natural colour in it. So if you want something coloured a bit like the sinew like that, you can't actually get that in that thread. So for doing your stitching, you obviously lock your thread onto your needle. So you thread your needle first, like I've done there. Pull your needle down slightly. Come in about 4 centimetres, 5 centimetres. Push your needle through the middle of the thread, like that. Push that up to the end of where the eye of the needle is. Pull the thread down towards the eye of the needle. Take the short end and then pull it over the end of the needle. Then pull on the long end, just to snug that up tight, and what that does is actually lock the needle onto the thread. There we go. So for your stitching run, I'm not going to teach you how to do sewing. You need to get the Al Stillman book about hand sewing leather if you want to learn a lot, but make sure you start in the second hole down from the end first, so that you're putting a double stitch in the end. That's all the sewing done. As you can see, it looks nice and neat. As I said in another video, when people are going, you know, why is, you know, on leather work, how do you do neat sewing? To me, it's about making neat holes. If you take the time to, you know, align your, do nice stitching grooves, mark your holes properly, drill your holes neatly, go over your holes again and everything, the stitching basically falls into place. You know, so if you get your holes neat and your stitching should be fine. In terms of finishing off the ends of these stitch runs, once you get to the end of your saddle stitching, basically you want to do 2.5 stitches back, so they end up with two threads poking out on the back, and then with that wax enamel thread you can just cut it off, melt it with a lighter just on the end, and then you should get a little sort of hard, just a little hard bit on the end that's melted. You can just poke that with a modelling tool sort of back into the hole, and you should end up with an almost sort of invisible end to your stitching. The last important step is just to go back over the stitching yet again with your stitch wheel, just to set it down into the holes and just neaten up the appearance of it. And that's all that needs doing with the stitching. What I'm going to do now, before I do anything else, is I'm just going to put these two rivets in that I talked about earlier. Remember, if you imagine that's the shape of the welt inside there now. Obviously this outside stitch line is binding the edge, but there's a big piece of welt inside there which currently has only got glue essentially sort of holding it together, which is probably ample, but in order to give it extra strength I'm just going to put two rivets in. The edges can now be finished off, sanded and beveled and dyed and everything. So the first thing with those is just going to be to actually round the corners. Where we've got these square corners, actually round those off. So take just a lump, 45 degree lump off the corner, and then just carve that around. There we go. So now these edges can be smoothed off. You can do this by hand with sandpaper, you can do it with a Dremel, with a sanding drum on, or what I do is actually run it down the belt sander, just because it's quickest. So I'm going to go outside and do that now. That's been sanded now, puts a nice smooth edge on. I like using the belt sander because it just turns that into a 2-minute job really, and because it's got a big surface area, it's very easy to just move it up and down the wheel and kind of do the whole thing at once and get it nice and flat, which is good. You can see that obviously the edges need beveling now. It's rubbed up kind of a little flap of leather there. So what we do is just take the edge beveler, and we can go ahead and bevel all the edges now. Once the edges have all been beveled like that, they can then just be carefully dyed before they're burnished. Or if you wanted to, you could burnish it without dyeing it. If you wanted a slightly different look, you just get a kind of paler edge then. But generally, the edges are going to want to be all dyed in. Obviously being careful not to get dye on the front of the sheath where it's already dyed. So just using the edge of the dauber to get the angles. Now that the dye has dried on the edge can actually be burnished. Burnishing the edges is just going to be a case of taking a sponge, dampening the edge of the sheath, not soaking it, just dampening it. And then the same tool that the straps were burnished with, just with the flat part, it's just a question of rubbing that up and down nice and straight to get the edge going. And then to get the curves going in as well, tend to lay it flat like that, work it in, and then basically you want to move the sheath around as you're rubbing up and down like that, so that you're turning the sheath over, and that just actually brings the edges in then. That's the burnishing finished. Burnishing shouldn't be a difficult job as long as you've done the sanding, really, because it's kind of smooth before you even start if you sand it properly. You can see that the edge has now gone smooth and like a black colour, and it's nice and shiny, and that just gives a really good finish to the edge. It looks and feels good on the edge when you burnish it, and it also protects the edges of the leather that obviously haven't got as much finish on, because it's kind of like the fleshy side. Just protects it from anything getting in there like water and grit and stuff. So it gives you a really good edge there. So I'm going to finish off the straps now. So what I'll do is, where it's going to bend over the sheath, I'm just going to wet it on the back of the strap, so it helps to bend without any sort of cracking and stressing. I'm going to take the belt blank again that we used before, make sure that I'm forming around the belt blank, so I've got actually space there, space there for the belt to pass through, like that. I'm going to come around to the front. I'm going to then wet the bottom again, where it's going to fold around. Again, just to stop that stressing as it comes over, help it keep the shape. And then basically all I'm going to do is make sure that it's aligned with the strap that's already attached. And once it's lined up, I'm going to press down with my thumbs over the press studs. What that's going to do is make two round marks, if you can see, which is where the press studs are, and that then gives me my position for punching the holes through to attach the press stud caps. And then the only thing that's left to do with that now is just to trim that off. So just bear in mind, you've got to get your finger under there to actually snap that off when you want to, but you also don't want it outside the line of the sheath, because you don't want it getting caught accidentally. So it's just a question of working out where you want that to finish. And then the end of the strap just needs finishing. So just chamfer the corners. And then it just needs beveling and dyeing and burnishing, the same as the rest of the cut strap does. And I'll just do the same for that front strap now as well. Those strap ends have been just trimmed and burnished to make them nice and neat. Straps should just close up now, no problems. And you can see that's how the straps look there. Again, that's had the belt blank behind it, so there should be no problems when it comes to putting this on, actually getting the belt through there as well. If you make a sheath like this for a very thick handled knife like a Woodlaw, then this area here gets a lot more contoured, and the belt kind of, you know, the belt can jam a little bit, so you need to allow even more space on a sheath like that. There is a limit really as to how thick of a handle you can make a sheath like this for, and the Woodlaws are getting a bit on the thick side. It's possible, but it's not as good as something that's thin like an F1, that's a lot more ideal. So that's as much as we're going to do in the video here. The only thing that's left to do with this sheath is to actually add the retention strap on, which I'm not going to go into, just because there's no need really. I've got to mess about doing some elastic and stuff on it, but if you were doing this yourself and you wanted to do a simple one, it'd just be another piece of strap. It can be the same thickness as this, and essentially all it is just either rivet or sew it to the collar there, so that it's gonna go on top like that, and then through to that straight bit, rivet or sew through to there, put one end of your press stud here, make sure you allow plenty of slack, wrap it around, and then just do the same as you've done here, mark off the position of the press stud, fit the press stud, trim it, and you're done. I'm not going to go into all that because the video's long enough as it is. But there's the actual sheath, which I think is looking okay. I think it looks really good. So I hope you've enjoyed the video, I hope it's answered a lot of your questions. If you've enjoyed the video series, there's a link in the description telling you how you can send a donation for the videos, if you think it's worth a donation as well. And have a look at all the other videos as well, because there's lots of information in there.